Victory song, amen.
Amen.
And they sung a new song, saying, God worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereon, for thou wast slain, and hast redeemed us to God by the blood of out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, the Lamb that was slain. Some say that the cross was invented by the Carthaginians. Some say the Phoenicians invented the cross. When the Egyptians came along, they used the cross. When Rome came along, they modified the cross and they used it for capital punishment. It was the Roman death machine. And the Romans had a knowledge of science. They knew how many whipping, how many torture someone could take before they would die. The cross was a symbol of suffering and punishment. It was a symbol of shame. Only runaway slaves and hardened criminals ended up on the cross, but Jesus was not a runaway slave, neither was he a hardened criminal. But how did he end up on the cross? There was a lot of under the table scheme going on. A friend of mine, the cross was a symbol of sun worship. I remember Semiramis, who had a son after Nimrod died, long after, and he was worshipped, and they said that his spirit went to the sun. They worshipped the sun back in those days. And she said that because he was worshipped as a god, that's all the descriptors, amen. She's a goddess, and when she got pregnant after he died, she said that's an immaculate conception. She had an illicit affair, because the only virgin birth was that of Jesus, amen. Mm-hmm. And she had a son by the name of Tammuz. The first son of us named T. He died at an early age, and he had 40 days of weeping that became the Christian Lent season. This is all of pagan origin, amen? And the cross was a symbol of sun worship. When she died, she went to the moon, the goddess of the moon, the goddess of fertility. That's why when people get married, they go off to the honeymoon and have the kissing place. But I want you to know the real kissing place is on Calvary, because justice and mercy hug and kiss each other, amen?
Amen.
God is a just God, but he's also a merciful God.
Amen.
The wages of sin is death. Romans 3:23, all have sinned, friend of man, and come short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God
is eternal life
through Jesus Christ our Lord, amen.
Amen.
The wages of sin is death. Somebody had to die. Adam had to die, because God said, in the day that you eat the earth, you shall surely die. But for God so loved the world that he gave the greatest gift, amen, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. So Jesus, from the very inception, in case sin should raise its ugly head, Jesus covenanted that he would die for the human race, amen?
Yes, he did.
And when the fullness of time came, God sent forth his son. Because he said, prepare me a body that I may dwell. He clothed his divinity, he gave up his divinity. He became as you and I. He walked upon the dusty roads and the rocky places of Palestine. He felt hungry, he was tired, he was thirsty. He was a human being. And he felt the effects of sin for 33 and a half years. He never sinned. The only perfect individual who ever walked upon the face of this earth, not even sinning by a word or thought, was Jesus Christ, amen?
Mm-hmm.
And yet, the people whom he healed and restored their sight to the blind, caused the deaf to hear, the dumb to speak. On that day, they said, crucify him. And Pilate took a basin and washed his hands and said, I am free from the blood of this innocent man. Three times Pilate said, I find no fault in him. you give a death sentence to someone you have found no fault in? Pilate was a weakling. He should have listened to his wife like some of us, amen? We would have been better off. I said that to the men in prison. As I spent about 20 years in the prison, I said to the brothers, you should have listened to your wives, amen? Maybe some of you wouldn't have been in here, but they thought that they were in charge. Just like all of us think that we are in charge, but we are never in charge. Either we are being controlled by the forces of evil, or we are being controlled by the God of heaven, amen?
Amen.
We are never in charge. We must allow ourselves to be controlled by the Spirit of God.
Amen.
It is said that a healthy person can last 4 days on the cross. And it was a sick sideshow for the onlookers. People didn't come to see men die, they come to see men suffer. Dying simply meant that the show was over and you can go home. The insects would come and take their bite as the breath still lingers in the flesh. The birds would come and pluck out your eyes while you're still on the cross. And can you imagine the pain and the suffering? You could hardly raise yourself up to breathe because you were spiked. And the Romans had a way of plaiting your legs in an unusual position. And your arm was outstretched, so you couldn't raise yourself up to breathe. And many died because of suffocation. The tongue was swollen out. And they died from suffocation because you could not raise yourself up to breathe. And even if you did, then the weight in your arms, you would just sag again. It was a mournful, terrible experience, a terrible way to die. And Jesus was beaten twice, 39 lashes twice, by the Roman rawhide whip or the cat o' nine tails. At the end of the leather strands were pieces of metal and bone and teeth. He was led as a lamb toward the slaughter, and yet he opened up his mouth. And that got the Roman elite soldiers outraged. He was silent. He did not murmur or complain. And Jesus was crucified naked on the cross. The artist paints a picture that he's properly draped, but in reality he was naked on the cross. Despising the shame for you and I, friend of mine. He shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. He shall see of the suffering, because by his suffering many shall behold the Lamb of God. Amen.
Amen.
To many, the cross was a symbol of failure, but that would be the greatest show that Christ will ever sit upon. Amen. It was a symbol of triumph. He died on the symbol of the sun. But on that great getting up morning, he arose with power. Amen. He conquered the sun god. We don't worship the sun. We worship the one who created the sun,
amen,
the moon and the stars. Amen. The creator of the universe. By the way, because he triumphed, because he lived, you and I can face tomorrow. Amen.
Amen.
And he's worthy. That's why he must be a somebody, amen? That's why he must be a somebody.
Yes, sir.
That's why the angel said to John, weep not. What is the Lamb that was slain to receive power, verse 12, and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessings? What is the Lamb that was found worthy to open the book? If you want to know what the seals are, it's in Revelation chapter 6, the six seals. The white horse, the red horse, the black horse, the pale horse, souls under the altar. I don't have the time to comment on this, on the seals, but I'll make a comment on the last one, the last seal. Verse 12 says, Revelation chapter 6, and I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, And the sun became as black as sackcloth of hair, the moon became as blood. The stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree cast it out timely figs, when she is shaken of a mighty wind. John said that the Lamb was worthy. He opened the seals, truth thereof. And the sixth seal, the angel said to Daniel, shut up the book and seal it thereof for the time of the end. And here, the Lamb, the one who is somebody, was worthy to open the book and loose the seals thereof. Talks about, and I beheld, and when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake. November 1, 1755, the great Lisbon earthquake. Almost all of Europe and North Africa affected an area of 4 million square miles. It was the mother of all earthquakes. It is estimated that 30,000 people lost their lives within 6 minutes. Almost 100,000 people died. The great Lisbon earthquake in Lisbon, Portugal. Bible students around the world recognize that this is the fulfillment of Bible prophecy. This is under the sixth seal. When he had opened the sixth seal, and the sun became as black as a cloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. May 19, 1780, around midday, the sun became as black as the midnight. The darkness was so thick that you could not see your hand in front of your face. There was no darkness like it since the children of Israel left Egypt. The darkness that surrounded the cross from the sixth hour to the ninth hour. God was in the darkness, amen. He could not reveal himself to the sun because light and darkness cannot coexist.
Amen.
Righteousness and unrighteousness cannot coexist. Bible says, and the sun became as black as a cloth of hair, and the moon became as, and this is all recorded in history, friend of mine. You can check it, it's like a PDA, amen?
Amen.
I tell you, the Bible is this whole authority, amen? Mm-hmm. He must be a somebody who can say something today, and the following week, it happens just as he says it. It only takes a somebody who can say something today, and in 10 years from now, as a matter of fact, Micah gave his prophecy 700 years before Jesus was even born. And Micah said where he would be born, in Bethlehem, Ephrata, Bethlehem of Judah, amen? The only book that contains prophecy is the Bible, amen? Not the Bhagavad Gita, not the Quran, even though the Quran mentions Jesus, but just as a prophet. The Bible is the only book of prophecy, and that makes it unique. Amen?
Yeah.
This is what had drawn my attention to the scriptures, the prophecies. When you can say something today and expect it to be fulfilled in the day and the year, in 2,000 years from now, you must be a somebody. Amen?
Amen.
You gotta be a somebody. Amen?
Amen.
I said exactly how it's going to happen. The sun became as black as a cloud of hair, the moon became as blood. And the cows came in from the pasture. The birds of the woodland fell silent. Cattle had to be brought in. And the darkness continued all the way past until midnight. And then the moon became as red as blood. Friend of mine, and it was not an eclipse because the moon was full that night. Amen. All recorded history. And the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as the fig tree cast it on timely figs, when she is shaken of a mighty wind. May 19, 1780. All across New England, one eyewitness said that the stars did not fall as fruits will fall from a ripe tree, but from a green tree, when she is shaken of a mighty wind. I remember back in the islands, we would climb up the mango trees, and we'd shake the green mangoes of those trees. Amen?
Amen.
Because you can use the mangoes green, full, ripe, you can use it anyhow. And we shake the branches. And if you're under the tree, and those are the big, tall trees, we climb on the branches and we shake the branches with our feet and with our hands, and the mangoes will fly like a bullet. And if you're anywhere in the vicinity, and if you get hit by one of those mangoes, that's what John says. That the stars will be flung. And I would just say that they did not fall like from fruits falling from a ripe tree, but as figs falling from a green tree when she's shaken of a mighty wind. Can you imagine? This must be a someone. Who can say exactly what's going to happen? And it happened just as recorded under the sixth seal. And heaven departed in a scroll when it is rolled together. And every island and mountain moved out of their place. And by the way, we are living between verses 13 and 14 of Revelation chapter 6 under the sixth seal. The earthquake has taken place. The great dark day, the moon became as blood, the falling of the stars. But verse 14 says, and the heavens departed as a scroll. This is talking about the second coming of Jesus. Amen. We are living between two verses of scriptures. And every mountain and island were moved out of their places, and the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the mighty men, and the chief captains, and every bondman and every freeman hid themselves in the dens and in the caves of the mountains and set the rocks and mountains, fallen us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? The question is in verse 17. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? Who shall be able to stand? Let's talk about the second coming of Jesus. Now, this somebody comes at the latter part of the sixth seal, because the question is asked in chapter 6 and the last verse, who shall be able to stand? Well, chapter 7 tells you who shall be able to stand.
Amen.
Because it does not talk about the seventh seal in Revelation chapter 7, but it talks about the seventh seal in Revelation chapter 8 and verse 1. And when he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven. So Jesus comes at the latter part of the sixth seal, because at the seventh seal, when it's open, there was silence in heaven. Mm-hmm. He's coming back with his glory.
Amen.
And the glory of the angel.
Amen.
And the glory of the Father. Heaven will be empty when Jesus comes again in all his triumph and glory.
Amen.
Not as a baby in Bethlehem or Judah, not to be spat upon or to receive spikes in his hands and feet, but he's coming back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He must be as somebody.
Amen.
To be riding on a white stallion. Amen.
Amen.
He must be as somebody. He's coming again. Amen.
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 Because he comes at the latter part of the sixth seal. We are living at the time of the end. When he comes again, it will be the end of time. And soon and very soon, we're going to see the King. Amen.
Amen.
I don't know about you, friend of mine, but I ain't going to let nobody turn me away from Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
The guy's nobody. As important as Jesus, amen. He's a kindred redeemer.
Amen.
And I've discovered that the kindred redeemer is closer than husband or wife or friend or brother or lover. Is closer than anybody, because he's a kinsman redeemer. The word redeem means to buy back, it means to purchase, it means to get back that which was gotten by fraud and deception. That's why he is worthy. Amen. We serve a mighty God. Amen. And he loves us with an everlasting love, what you say.
Amen.
I want to be that number when the saints go marching in.
Amen.
What a day of rejoicing it's going to be when Jesus comes again in all his important glory as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, it's going to be all right, amen. Lord, Negro spiritual will say, trouble us thus always. Joy comes in the morning, what is it? Can you imagine? There's going to be no more sickness, and no more pain, and no more sorrow, and no more crying, no more eyeglasses, and no more wrinkles on our faces, and no more false teeth, and no more gray hair, and no more arthritis. I don't know. I'm going to look like Rod, amen. I'm going to have a full head of hair, amen.
Amen.
Lush.
I know I'm good looking, but I'm going to be better looking, what do you say, amen?
Yes.
All of us are beautiful in the sight of God, what do you say? If you know nothing, you're not good looking. You can be looking good in Jesus, amen?
Amen.
He knows us. Everybody can be looking good in Jesus.
Amen.
I'm proud because I'm a child of the King, amen?
Amen.
There could be no more sickness, no more pain, no more sorrow, no more crying. No more glasses, no more wrinkles in our faces, no more false teeth, no more gray hair, can you imagine? No more arthritis, no more hypertension, no more prisons, no more hospitals. There ain't going to be no more death.
Amen.
When Jesus comes again.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
2 Corinthians 15.
Glory to your
name, Jesus. This corruption must put on incorruption, amen. And this mortal must put on immortality. When this corruption shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying, verse 51, that is swallowed up in victory.
Hallelujah.
Because when Jesus rose, got up on a great getting upon him, he looked over his shoulder and he said, oh death, where is thy sting of grave? Where is thy victory? He insulted death and the grave. He said, I'm alive, and I'm alive forevermore. And because he lived, we can face tomorrow, what you say.
Amen.
We serve a risen Savior. He's worthy. He must be a somebody.
Amen.
He must be a somebody. Amen.
Amen.
I don't know a friend of mine, but one of these is going to be all right. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus is coming again.
Amen.
What a day of rejoicing that's going to be.
Amen.
It won't be long. We are living between two verses of scriptures. Soon and very soon the trumpet is going to sound and the angels are going to shout, Jesus is coming again. I want to be in that number. How about you, friend of mine?
Amen.
How about you?
Amen. How fast he comes. Amen.
Are we willing to weep for our salvation as John did? To open the book, to weep for others, that they will make it through those pearly gates. On those glittering hinges, we're going to walk on the streets of gold. We're going to stand on a sea of glass. We're going to sing that victory song. Amen.
Amen.
How about a friend of mine? One of these days it's going to be all right. John says he saw the holy city, New Jerusalem. I want to be that number when it says come and sing it. Amen. There might be somebody here. You want to make that decision. You want to recommit. Rededicate your life to Jesus. If that's your decision, I just want you to raise your hand with me. Anybody else? Is that your decision? God records every decision we make for him. Amen.
Amen.
We just want to pray that our names will be retained in the Lamb's Book of Life.
Amen.
So when Jesus comes again, it will be well with our souls, friend of mine. As every head is bowed and every eye is closed, loving Heavenly Father, we come before your throne of grace to give you thanks for being so good to us. Seal our commitments, O Lord, for time and for eternity. And may nothing turn us from the straight and narrow way, because we have a somebody who is for us. Forgive our every sin, O Lord. Heal our backsliding, our murmurings, our complainings. And by your grace, O Lord, may you use us as instruments in your hands to be a blessing to others, so that your name will be glorified and we will be blessed. Thank you, Lord, for being so good to us. For we ask these mercies in Jesus' precious name. Amen. I invite you to stand as we look at our closing hymn.